Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, hear about a new law that expands federal protections for trade secrets. Also tonight, new research creates edible supercapacitors. And we'll hear from Dolan Ellis, celebrating 50 years as Arizona's official balladeer. Those stories next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. A group of education advocates today call for more education funding. This after a passage of Prop 123, which puts $3.5 billion into schools over the next 10 years. But advocates say that those Prop 123 funds were supposed to go to education in the first place and that schools are still down $1.2 billion from pre-recession levels. Governor Ducey has said that the next step for Arizona education is to focus on outcomes, including an improvement in test scores and college attendance rates. President Obama recently signed into law the Defend Trade Secrets Act, which allows companies to file civil lawsuits for trade secret violations under federal law. Here to explain why this is a big deal for Arizona companies is Kim Warshawski of Phoenix law firm Ballard Spahr. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much, Ted.
What exactly is the Defend Trade Secrets Act?
Well, as you noted, this is a new federal protection for trade secrets, and it expanded the old federal law to allow for civil remedies under federal law. Trade secrets was what the one area of intellectual property that was not protected by federal law. So now employers can come in to federal court and claim trade secret protection.
So basically, prior to this, civil action only under state law?
Yes, only under state law. And there was a what was called as the Uniform Trade Secrets Act that was adopted by most states. But as each state adopted the various Uniform Trade Secrets Act, they had different changes. So the federal law does not replace the state laws, but it supplements them and provides a common ground for trade secret protection.
I was going to ask that question because we hear about preemption all the time here
Yes.
in Arizona. So the state laws still exist, still on the books?
They do still exist. So there are two levels of protection. But again, from an employer perspective, this allows the employer to go into federal court and to know at the outset how the law is going to be interpreted without taking into account various state changes and idiosyncrasies.
So define a trade secret. What are we talking about here?
Well, at a 40,000 foot level and at a very basic level, a trade secret is anything that a business has that provides value to the business. And importantly, it's secret. So it's something that the company holds near and dear, like customer lists, pricing models. The quintessential trade secret is the Coca-Cola recipe. Mm. It's something that's important, it's valuable, and it's not something that's widely distributed.
So when a trade secret is considered stolen, how do you know?
Well, you tend to see a trade secret to be stolen if you see ex-employees that are going out to former customers or you see pricing information. Under the old state laws, you would see a lot of companies that would sue if an employee left and would go to a competitor. And you would see a lot of employers suing under what's called the inevitable disclosure doctrine. This employee was working for me, they're now working for my competitor. This employee had access to my trade secrets, now they're with my competitor, and surely they'll use the trade secrets.
And as far as remedies are concerned, compensatory, punitive damages, those sorts of things?
Yes, there is some punitive damages and trebling of damages and attorney's fees, but there's a caveat under the Defend Trade Secrets Act. Under the Trade Secrets Act that Obama just signed, employees have immunity if they disclose trade secrets to the government as part of an investigation. And it's so-called whistleblower protection.
Yeah.
And so employers now have to be careful that in their employment agreements and their confidentiality agreements, they provide notice to the employees of this immunity. If the employers do not provide notice of the immunity, then punitive damages and willful damages will not be available.
Interesting. I notice as well the ex parte seizure orders. Well, now what's that all about?
Yes, the ex parte seizure orders are what you see on TV when the sheriff's office comes in and grabs the goods. Here employers have an opportunity if there's been trade secrets that have been stolen and you meet certain requirements, so-called exceptional circumstances. You have the opportunity to go in without notice to the other side and grab the trade secrets. From there, the employee or the accused company has 7 days that request a hearing and the court holds those trade secrets protected. The key with the ex parte seizure order, though, is that you have to show, it's a very high level of proof, you have to show absolutely extraordinary circumstances, that if the trade secrets were to be out there in the possession of the other side, that you would suffer extreme damage and that the trade secrets would essentially evaporate during the course of the case.
The idea being that you're doing it to stop these secrets from being passed on.
Well, and also that if something is not done now, the remedy at the back end of the case will not make the harmed plaintiff whole.
I see.
It's cautioned that this is a remedy, but this is going to be a very difficult remedy based upon the way the law is written to obtain. Here again, there's also some concern as the law was being passed that employers would use this ex parte seizure remedy as a way to embarrass the other side. Mm. So if there has been publication of the ex parte seizure order or the request, that shuts down the request.
Right.
So we can't have games in the media.
Interesting. Okay. Good idea to update confidentiality agreements?
It's absolutely essential to update the confidentiality agreements. If you don't provide the employees with notice of their whistleblower immunity, then there are certain remedies, including attorney's fees, that are not available for the employers should the trade secrets be taken. So we are advising all of our clients to go ahead and update your confidentiality agreements, your non-disclosure agreements, any written agreement that you have with your employee dealing with confidentiality and secret business information absolutely must be updated.
And this is not retroactive, correct?
No, it's not. So it the day that President Obama signed the law is the day that it starts. We've seen a few lawsuits being filed across the country now, so we obviously don't know how it's going to play out, but you don't have the federal protection until the federal laws.
And last question here. This basically, a bottom line, just kind of brings uniformity to the whole situation. Is that the idea here?
Absolutely, and it brings a level of stability. Different states have different laws in terms of what is a trade secret, what isn't a trade secret, and whether or not the trade secrets have been misappropriated. One other key issue that, and I mentioned it a little bit earlier, that this law makes it clear that the so-called inevitable disclosure doctrine is not going to be accepted. So because an employee moves from one employer to another and has the potential to use trade secrets will not be the basis for an injunction going forward. That's a protection for the employees. Obviously, they cannot misappropriate the trade secrets, but that's one important distinction that now this federal law has made sure is clear.
All right. Good stuff. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining
us. Thanks so much.
Get the inside scoop on what's happening at Arizona PBS. Become an insider. You'll receive weekly updates on the most anticipated upcoming programs and events. Get the insider delivered to your email inbox. Visit azpbs.org to sign up today.
Tonight's edition of Arizona Technology and Innovation looks at something called edible electricity, specifically a supercapacitor that can be eaten. Here to tell us more about their research into ingestible electronics is ASU Associate Professor of Mechanical Engineering, Han-Ching Jiang, and research team member, Wen-Wen Xu. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, edible supercapacitors. Explain, please.
Okay, so the whole story started when we are examining the landscape of current implantable devices. So implant device has been revolutionized the care of patients. But the problem for current implant medical device is you have to go to surgery and the patient has complications possibly. So recently, biodegradable and bioresolvable electronics appear, so they can only one type of surgery is dissolved eventually. But the problem for that device is they have very limited choice of materials. They still use silicon, or metal, or copper in a device. It's not very friendly to human body. Then we are trying to ask ourselves a question. Do we have other way to access electronics to the human body except the ingestible, permanent, or dissolvable electronics? We think about, can we use the digestive system?
Yeah.
Can we through the stomach?
Right.
So that's all started.
And that's how it all started. And you wind up with what, food that's electronically charged? Well, what do we got here? What's going on?
We choose the materials based on our experience of our lives. So we choose the, for example, we choose cheese. Cheese don't like water, you know, so it can work as the segregation layer. And the activated charcoal has high electric conductivity, right? So it can work as the electrode.
So it's activated charcoal, mm-hmm. Even like Indian food has gold leaf and these kind. I think we have a video here to show. Take us through exactly what we're watching here as far as this stuff being made. I mean, what's
sure.
going on here?
Sure.
So you got your egg there.
The egg is is a bonding layer.
Okay.
Because you steam egg became very sticky. And the charcoal is the porous material can absorb the electrons.
And so you add water there, and you do, it looks like we're watching the cooking channel, Chopped or something here. More egg white. And
not sticky enough.
Gold foil. What's going on here, Wen? What's this all about?
And gold, you know, in the supercapacitor, we need a current collector. And gold is a good electric conductivity material. So we choose gold as the current collector.
And you're stacking stuff up here. All this stuff is, you seal it there. So what happens once you swallow it? What happens once it gets inside you?
So the packaging material prevents the water gas into the system. So intact, make the inside still intact in the after you swallow it. So you can deliver current to the GI system.
Is it entirely biodegradable?
All material is from the food, from grocery store. The interesting story, we got a reimbursement from department that asked us why you purchase food and using
yes.
research.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a good question. Why are you doing it? Well, so once it's inside, supercapacitors do what? Is this like an endoscopy? What's going on?
Actually, it works like a battery. It can provide current for a device. And also, it can kill the harmful bacteria in your digestive system.
So it can do that?
Yeah, it can do.
But can you attach a camera somewhere along the line?
Yeah, of course.
So then it could be like an endoscopy, couldn't it? I mean,
yeah, it can be an edible power source. Mm.
All right, so what does a supercapacitor taste like?
Yeah.
It's basically cheese. Cheese, right.
Like
it's a crispy
actually.
Cheese.
But have you tasted this yet? Have you tried it?
Yeah, I ate it.
You've tried it.
Yeah, I cannot force my student to eat this stuff, right? It's all food.
So it can power a camera. It can kill bacteria.
Right.
How does it do that?
So kill bacteria is you deliver current, you change the local environment of the bacteria, you know, living environment, they just disappear, you know.
So, what we saw there was a relatively small bite. Is that the size of bite you need?
Yes. Basically, a small size of similar size of the medicine capsule.
So, is there any concern of contaminating the bite? What if something breaks?
No.
There's nothing to break though. It's food, right?
Yeah, it's food. It's totally safe for human.
That's the biggest advantage of this one compared with ingestible electronics. Here is all material is food, the most friendly material we can take to the GI tract. We don't concern about the contamination or other issues because we don't.
Yeah.
We eat food every day.
So what's next in all this? I mean, I heard you can make these things on 3D printers in the future. That's going to be the goal?
So next step, we want to make the entire circuitry from food edible. We can do function. This one, we can have a big step forward is we can truly engage with the GI tract. Engage means we can do sensing and actuation. And what we are demonstrating with kill bacteria is actuate with the GI tract.
Okay.
Sensing means we can sense the bacteria in situ and on real time. That can consider a big breakthrough in that area. But challenge is how we make material, the food material, really and function as very good semiconductor and metals and other materials.
Yeah, you get
that's a big challenge.
There's a lot of food out there. You got to start testing. Last question for you. What do your friends say when you tell them what you're doing? Do they think you're nuts?
Oh, they said, wow, amazing. Are you kidding me?
Well, it is amazing, and you're not kidding. It's good to have you both here. Congratulations on your research. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Tonight's edition of Arizona Art Beat features Dolan Ellis, who is celebrating his 50th year as Arizona's official state balladeer.
Well, the man in the big hat is buying. Drink up while the drinking is free. Drink up to the cowboys at dead or
And we welcome Dolan Ellis back to Arizona Horizon. Good to see you again.
It's wonderful to be here.
That is my favorite Stephen Fromholtz song. That is, I love,
well,
he
you.
Wrote it while in Cave Creek, didn't he?
Yes, he did. He wrote it out of Harold's Cave Creek Corral.
Yeah, the man with the big hat. You're 50 years.
50 years, Ted. I can't believe it's been that long, but they tell me it has.
So by now, I think you should know what your official duties are as the state's official balladeer. What are they? What do you do?
Well, I write songs, I take photographs, and I sing about Arizona to help people to remember what this wonderful state is all about.
When you first, 1966?
1966.
Did you succeed someone in this position, or are you the first and only?
It was the first and only. It was created for me. And I was not only Arizona's first state balladeer, I was the first state balladeer of any state of the United States of America.
My goodness. What was your reaction? Did they ask you? Did you campaign for this? How did this work?
It was Governor Goddard who created it. And I had just come back from being with the New Christy Minstrels, which your younger audience may not remember that group, but we were pretty big at the time. And I came back I came back to do what I'm doing today. I've always had this calling to be in my state, and Governor Goddard recognized that and made me the official balladeer, and every governor since then has followed that.
When you were first named the state's official balladeer, what did you expect to do? And now, when you look back, were you close, or was it very different than what it turned out?
Well, I kind of made up my own job description, you know. By the way, it doesn't pay anything, okay? It's an honorary
I understand.
Position. But yes, I just, when I was given that, I thought, you know, that's just what I want to be in life. That's just what I want to do. I'd received a lot of awards and honors and that sort of thing before that, and I could have taken that certificate and put it on my mantle with a lot of things. But I said, no, this is it. This is what I want to be.
Why did you want, I mean, you pursued a commercial career in the sense of joining the New Christy Minstrels. You guys were on all sorts of TV shows. You
toured
the country.
Well, I had to make some money.
Yeah,
you know, they don't pay anything on this job.
But what happened with that group, and why did you, it sounds like you kind of realized maybe this life isn't for me.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, Ted. I have always, you know, I've always had this unexplainable calling to be in Arizona and in the deserts in particular. There's something about the Sonoran Desert and me that...
Yeah, did you ever second guess that decision early on?
I had no choice. Really?
In the sense of really. It just wasn't there, you?
I have always had such a drive to do... I moved here from Kansas. You know, when I was a kid in Kansas, I knew at 6 years of age I wanted to live in Arizona. Honestly, it's spooky. It really is.
Yeah,
it's very spooky.
Back to the Christy Minstrels real quickly. Now, you have reunited with the group to some extent, correct?
Yes, I traveled. I rejoined the group about 12 years ago, and I've been traveling nationally doing nostalgic sort of programs with them and concerts. And I just retired about a year and a half ago to come back to Arizona full time.
Yeah.
And to really focus in on my work on the next chapter of my life.
Let's talk about that previous chapter though, especially the one in Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
You moved here in 1959.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I just knew that I wanted to be here. I knew, honestly, at 6 years of age, I knew I wanted to live in Arizona. And when I got old enough to make my own decisions, I went to Kansas University. When I got out of school there, I came directly to Arizona. I was in the television industry with Channel 10, which was KOOL-TV.
Sure was, yeah.
And owned by Tom Chauncey and Gene Autry back in the
That's day. Right, it was.
And I went to work with them as a floor man, and then I became a switcher and an audio man. I did everything there was to do in television.
As the kid in camp, probably watched a lot of movies, John Wayne movies.
I think that had a lot to do with it.
Monument Valley, you saw all those.
I think the Roy Rogers movies
yes.
had a lot of, I think also that National Geographic magazine had a lot to do with it.
So when you finally came out here and you saw Arizona firsthand and you got to kind of get around a little bit, did it meet expectations?
Absolutely. In fact, is what I saw in Arizona as an artist, I think a lot of people weren't aware of, and that is I could see the embers of the old West still alive in the culture out here. And I knew it wasn't going to last because this place was exploding
yes.
in those days.
Yes.
And I just knew that once those old cowboys and once those trading posts and once those old ways of Arizona disappeared, that it wouldn't be but another 20, 30, 40, 50 years before it would all be gone. And so I absorbed it like a sponge. I was like a dog on a bone. Man, I wrote and I took pictures and I have a wonderful collection of I've written now over 300 songs about Arizona people, places, and things in the old ways.
50 years as the state's official balladeer. We're going to,
yes,
in a second here, I'm going to ask you to play us out here. But I do want to ask about the importance of music in your life. I mean, when you sit back, it is your life. It's
you. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, I'm now 81 years of age. And knock on wood, my health is really pretty good, and I think it's the music that has done it for me. To be able to have and to be able to write that poetry and to express myself, I've been a very, very lucky man.
You have indeed. Well, congratulations on 50 years as the state's official
yes.
balladeer. Pick us a song here, whatever you want to play, and play us out. Congratulations, and it's good to see you again. Thanks
Thank
for joining
you. It's
me.
Good to see you, too. I'll shake your hands before I go to
go.
Work here. A song about the Bradshaw Mountains.
Sounds good.
That old road going up there to Crown King, well, that was a railroad bed at one time. Frank Murphy's Impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. They said it couldn't be built, that wouldn't wilt or wither his plan. And he proved them all wrong when his train chugged along with its payload. Frank Murphy's Impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. Some said he was crazy and his logic was hazy and he thought through a hole in his hat. Frank Murphy was counting to build a track up the mountain. He ought to be smarter than that. So he blasted and drilled through the mountains and hills, shoveled and he tunneled away.
Folks in Crown King were all cheering and singing when his train reached Tom on that day. Yay! Frank Murphy's impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. They said it couldn't be built. That wouldn't wilt or wither his plan. And he proved them all wrong when his train chugged along with its payload. Frank Murphy's impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. Now you see, there isn't that much difference between drilling holes in the side of a mountain for a railroad tunnel as there is for drilling holes in the side of a mountain for a gold mine. Except, of course, in railroad tunnels, you don't usually find any gold. I repeat, you don't usually find any gold. Well, he blasted and drilled through the mountains and hills as he tunneled his way to the top. There in the hole lay a rich vein of gold. Frank's railroad, it came to a stop. Well, his men up and quit, but they kept all their picks. Gandy dancers, they were no more. They became instant miners instead of track-a-liners as they stuffed all their pockets with ore. True story, Frank Murphy's impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. They said it couldn't be built. That wouldn't wilt or wither his plan. And he proved them all wrong when his train chugged along with its payload. Frank Murphy's impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. Now up the mountain he built through the rocks and the silt, 12 switchbacks up a sheer mountain side. 6,000 feet up to meet Turkey Creek from Cleeter to the Oroville mine. But he worked not in vain, cause he got that train to the rich Bradshaw mother load mines. The engine burned coal and it turned it to gold on the impossible railroad line. Frank Murphy's impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad. They said it couldn't be built. That wouldn't wilt or wither his plan. And he proved them all wrong when his train chugged along with its payload. Frank Murphy's impossible Bradshaw Mountain Railroad.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Funding for Curate. The Arizona Arts and Culture Fund is made possible by Signal Society members Eleanor Light and Judith Hards, and by you can become a curator of the arts on Arizona PBS. For more information, call 602-496-8888.